Hello, am I audible? Samved mentioned about thriller, I thought of two books and I chose the book of Sherlock Holmes because the first experience of thrill of my life was with Sherlock Holmes, where I was in fifth grade and I used to hide under the blanket and put a torchlight and read this book. And my mother used to kind of get angry because I was continuously reading book the whole night. And about the author, very recently I discovered that the author, Arthur Conan Doyle, he himself was a very spiritual and he was a Freemason. Freemason is a school of spirituality. That is another story. And the author himself was a doctor. He was a medical doctor. And most of his stories are based on lives of soldiers and deduction and analysis. And all his books are, they are a kind of milestones in crime fiction and thrill. And he has also written some humorous stories. And even when we read the complete works of Sherlock Holmes, we find here and there small humorous conversations happening between Dr. Watson and Sherlock Holmes. And he has written few books about for the children also, but I haven't ventured into that area. And now coming to the book, I still have the book with me. It is The Complete Works of Sherlock Holmes, Part 1. And the part I would like to talk and which actually still remains in my memory over these years is the first part where the author, he calls himself Dr. Watson. The author is posted in some Indian subcontinent because there is some war going on and he's posted there as a doctor. And when he lands in the Indian subcontinent, he realizes that he's in deep mess because already there is a war situation. And from the Indian port of Mumbai, he's shifted to Kandahar, which is in Afghanistan, which again takes around 2 months for him to travel. He's put on a horse and he's asked to go to Kandahar. And in Kandahar, he is demoted from his post of a brigadier doctor to some other lower post. And there also, Dr. Watson speaks about some not very good experiences. And he speaks of an experience where a war bullet, it grizzles his shoulder and he's injured. And again, he shifted to another hospital where he's put for 3 months. And after 3 months, he's in such a pathetic condition that his mind and body have completely given up. And the queen or the Britishers, they decide that he's no more fit to be in the war situation. The doctor is no more fit. And he's again sent back to his country. And that is where how he lands back in London. And in London, he comes across his old friend called Stamford. And he feels very happy looking at Stamford because all this while he was in another country with another kind of not his own people, that is what he mentions. And when he sees Stamford, it kind of brings a new life to him. And he tells Stamford that I'm looking for a room to share with a unique and a very queer and a strange person like me. So then Stamford says that I know of another person, and that is where Stamford takes him and introduces him to Sherlock Holmes. Why I'm talking more about the author and Dr. Watson here is because I feel that if it was not the imagination and the fiction of Arthur Conan Doyle, the character of Sherlock Holmes wouldn't have been molded in such a intriguing and an inquisitive and thrilling way. It is he who has actually designed it in his mind and put it as Sherlock Holmes. And throughout all the stories, Dr. Watson is the constant companion of Sherlock Holmes, where sometimes he protects Sherlock Holmes, he gives suggestions to Sherlock Holmes. And the best part is there is an unspoken, unwritten understanding between Watson and Holmes, that when Holmes goes into periods of complete silence where he doesn't move as if he's in a trance, Watson doesn't go and disturb him. Watson understands that Holmes is analyzing some case. And in the last story also, where Watson and Montgomery, they kind of face each other. And everybody thinks that Holmes is dead because he's jumped into the sea and Montgomery has killed Holmes. It's Watson who again and again hints us that Holmes may not be dead. And that is how he brings the second part, the return of Sherlock Holmes, to the public. And all his stories, The Speckled Band, The Blue Carbuncle, all are short stories. In each of the stories, he brings out one new aspect and a unique facet of Holmes. And when he meets Holmes for the first time, he tries to analyze Sherlock Holmes, and he says that he feels it is very funny that Holmes doesn't know that the planets move around the sun. And when he asks Holmes that how can he miss such a basic knowledge, Holmes says that it doesn't matter to him if the Earth goes round the moon or the moon goes round the Earth, because what is happening is to happen. So from there, what Dr. Watson starts observing each and every activity of Holmes, and he gets inspired by the eccentric intelligence of Holmes, where Holmes says that the brain is like an attic where you cannot store all the information. You have to keep on removing the old unused information and keep on putting new information. And he says that the brain does not have elastic walls. You cannot stretch the walls of the brain to keep on dumping information into brain. You have to periodically let go the information which is not useful to us. So when I was reading this book as 11-year-old, it didn't strike much to me. But now when I'm into the field of healing and into the spirituality, I can understand what the underlying message Dr. Watson is trying to give. He's just asking people to let go the unnecessary things in life and just fix the mind to the things which are actually relevant. And throughout the entire thing, Holmes has a shadow in Dr. Watson, who keeps on following him in every place and in every moment in each of his adventures which he undertakes. And all of them are documented in a very beautiful way. And sometimes I force myself to believe that this is not a piece of fiction, but it is a reality, because when I read, I can visualize, I can feel what is happening. And very recently, I came to know that most of the stories of Sherlock Holmes have been converted into the Indian into Bengali by Sharadendu Bandopadhyay as Byomkesh Bakshi. And those who have read Sherlock Holmes can find a lot of similarity between Byomkesh Bakshi and Sherlock Holmes. So I would definitely recommend all to read this book, though the language is a little difficult. But I am sure that if we read, we can get through the essence. And it has a lot of British touch and British words. Like, there is one story called Five Orange Pips. So when I was a young girl, I never knew what is a pip. And later I found out that the one crescent shape of an orange, that is known as a pip. So this book actually enhances the vocabulary, and it also triggers somewhere the imaginary and the analytical aspect of the brain. So I would strongly recommend this book. I think there's a movie also with the name Sherlock Holmes. And children, though, must read. All the children here and all those who have not read should definitely read both the volumes of Sherlock Holmes, Complete Work of Sherlock Holmes and The Return of Sherlock Holmes. And definitely the entire credit goes to Arthur Conan Doyle. And even to this day, a lot of letters they received at 221B Baker Street, which is the residential address of Holmes in the entire book. So even to this day, the lot of mails and lot of letters come to that address, and lot of people want to visit Holmes whenever they visit 221B Baker Street. And what I heard recently was there is a museum being set up in that place regarding Holmes and Dr. Watson, that means the author, the Conan Doyle. So I think that is what I wanted to say about Sherlock Holmes as my experience as a child and as my experience now when I have grown up. That's it. Thank you.